Hi, let's talk about the hepatic portal system. In this video, we'll discuss the hepatic portal system and differentiate it from the caval system, in particular, differentiating the hepatic portal vein from the hepatic veins. We'll also discuss examples of portocaval anastomoses. So a portal system is any system of vasculature which connects two capillary beds. In the case of the hepatic portal system, we're dealing with a venous portal system, and this is going to connect all of the capillaries within the walls of the gastrointestinal tract from the abdominal part of the esophagus through the rectum and anal canal, and it's going to deliver that blood to hepatic sinusoids. So there are very many tributaries. If you think about all of the branches of the celiac trunk and superior mesenteric artery and inferior mesenteric artery, which supply the gastrointestinal tract with blood, there are typically commensurate veins which drain that gastrointestinal tract with blood. Now, the major pathways are going to include the inferior mesenteric vein, the superior mesenteric vein, and the splenic vein. Here on the right, we can see examples of this in the cadaveric photograph we have. We can see the superior mesenteric vein coming up here, meeting the splenic vein, into which the inferior mesenteric vein drains. That inferior mesenteric vein typically drains into the splenic vein, but it may also drain into the superior mesenteric vein. Where the splenic vein and superior mesenteric vein coalesce, which we can see right there, that vessel is the hepatic portal vein, sometimes just called the portal vein. The origin of the portal vein is typically just posterior to the neck of the pancreas. And that portal vein is going to be conveyed up to the porta hepatis of the liver within the hepatoduodenal ligament. So blood then is going to those hepatic sinusoids. Another source of blood from those or to those hepatic sinusoids will be from the hepatic artery proper, or HAP. So blood from the hepatic artery proper and blood from the hepatic portal system is going to mix in the hepatic sinusoids. And then blood from those hepatic sinusoids will drain from the liver via hepatic veins. Typically, there are three hepatic veins, and they're draining into the inferior vena cava. So any vessel that drains into either the superior or inferior vena cava are what we would refer to as part of the caval system, whereas any vessel that drains into the hepatic portal vein is part of the portal system. So we can differentiate these two venous systems one from another. And there are cases where these two systems come in contact with one another. Now, portal hypertension is an increase of pressure within the hepatic portal system. Generally, this is a result of impeded blood flow to, through, or away from the liver, but its most typical cause is from cirrhosis of the liver. With cirrhosis of the liver, or any other impedance to the flow of blood, pressure builds within the portal system. This increase of pressure may lead to varices between both portal tributaries and nearby caval tributaries. So, as a for instance, in the distal esophagus, which we can see here, there are going to be branches from the left gastric vein. These branches of the left gastric vein, which are portal in nature, are draining similar submucosa as esophageal veins. These esophageal veins are part of the caval system. They feed into the esophagus system, which feeds into the superior vena cava. So with increased portal pressure, blood can be shunted from the portal to the caval, and we can see dilations of these veins in the submucosa that we refer to as varices. So esophageal varices tend to be very frequently associated with portal hypertension. But there are also other regions where these portocaval anastomoses can occur and varices may occur. So for instance, another is within the peri-umbilical region. Peri-umbilical region is the area around the belly button, where there are superficial epigastric veins. These are not to be confused with the superior and inferior epigastric veins that are found within the rectus abdominis. These are found within the hypodermis, and these are going to drain down into the femoral veins. What can happen with portal hypertension is that the para-umbilical vein can become dilated, and this can shunt blood into these superficial epigastric veins and cause them to dilate. And the dilation of these veins about the umbilicus produces a very distinctive pattern of swirls and tortuosities of these veins. This is referred to as caput medusae, or the head of Medusa, because it superficially resembles Medusa's head with the snakes. This isn't exactly the nicest way to refer to this particular morphology, but you will hear this sometimes in the clinic. Another region or regions where we see varices occur are between various retroperitoneal veins. Any place that we have a secondarily retroperitoneal organ veins which drain these veins that are adjacent to the lumbar veins of the body wall, we can see this occur. And then also we can see these varices in the rectum and superior anal canal, in particular in the submucosa of the anorectal region. Here we have superior rectal veins, which are portal, that are pushing blood out to both middle and inferior rectal veins, which are caval. So the middle rectal veins are feeding into the internal iliac vein, whereas the inferior rectal veins are feeding into the internal pudendal veins, which then feed into the internal iliac veins. So we'll talk about this more when we discuss the rectum and anal canal. Some people refer to these varices as internal hemorrhoids, but more on that later. Portal hypertension is a symptom which can be reduced surgically so as to prevent any bleeds from these varices. So the modern treatment for this is something called a TIPS procedure. TIPS is short for transjugular intrahepatic portosystemic shunt. This is when an interventional radiologist is going to guide a wire through the internal jugular vein, down through the brachiocephalic and superior vena cava, through the right atrium, into the inferior vena cava, and then into the hepatic veins, and into the liver, where a shunt is introduced between the hepatic veins and the hepatic portal veins. So this allows an increased pressure in the portal system to flow directly into the caval system. And it does bypass the liver sinusoids. Another older method of shunting involved placing a shunt between the left renal vein and the splenic vein. The left renal vein and the splenic vein are in very close association with one another. They're both very large bore veins. And so you might also hear on the boards or see on the boards examples of left renal vein, splenic vein shunting. So we've discussed the hepatic portal system, its tributaries, areas where portal veins and caval veins come into close contact, and we can see shunting or portocaval anastomosing. This is your summary slide. Thank you for your time.